Good evening and welcome to our May 22nd, 2018 Ogden City Council meeting. We appreciate your presence here, whether you're here live or whether you're watching on the Facebook Live feed. We appreciate you being here. Let the roll call reflect that all council members are present here today. We'll turn the time to Vice Chair Nadolski for our Pledge of Allegiance.
Thank you. Please rise and join me.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Now, if you would join us for a moment of silence. Thank you. The first item on our agenda today is a recognition of Jay Hill, and we've asked Councilmember Blair if he would make that presentation today. So we are all, he brought us all these jerseys, so that was a new experience for most of us, but and that's why we have them on.
Yes, thank you, Chair Heyer. It's my honor to read this. It reads, the Ogden City Council and Mayor proudly recognize Weber State University's Jay Hill for providing invaluable contributions to the Ogden community. After a record-breaking 11 wins, a highest-ever national ranking of fifth, a Big Sky Championship, and the deepest FCS run, ever playoff run in program history, Wildcat football coach Jay Hill was named the 2017 Coach of the Year in the state of Utah by the Utah Sports Commission. He is the first Weber State coach to receive the honor since its inception in 2012. Coach Hill's vision and leadership has taken Weber State's football team to new heights and has brought a sense of pride and engagement to our community. He thrives in his role as an ambassador for Weber State athletics and the Ogden community, both while coaching at home and on the road. We appreciate the hard work and effort Coach Hill dedicates to representing the Ogden community in a positive light. We wish him our best in his future endeavors and are confident that his success will continue for many years to come. And we've got a plaque here for Coach Hill. I'd like to ask him to come forward.
Coach, we want to take some photos.
Absolutely.
So.
Thank you again.
Want to come up too?
No. Go ahead. I'll take it.
He's taller. He's shorter than the players.
We all in it?
Are
you want him to move?
Are you in?
There you go. There we go. All right.
Hold on. I'm in. Yeah.
Okay.
I think we should all show a W, don't you?
Yeah.
Picture of you and your new recruits.
Yeah. 2018 signing class.
You want to flash a little more?
Yeah.
Whoa, wait.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, coach, a little more.
We would like to hear from you also.
Absolutely. Well, what an honor. I appreciate the recognition and everything that you guys have done for us as a city and the support that we receive from the council. I appreciate that. Our team now has been down here twice. I think two of the last 3 years we've been down here, and the recognition's important to the players that they know that they've got backing from the government or from the officials from the city, and we appreciate that. It's a great honor to be able to come down here, and I love Ogden and what it represents. We love living here. It's been great for me, been great for the kids, and so anyway, I'm proud to be here, and we love everything that's going on up at Weber State. Today I just got off the road recruiting. I was doing northern Utah, but we started at Weber High School and went north, and man, it's just an awesome area to get out and see the local kids and the talent that we've been able to acquire, and most of it's local. So we're proud of what we're building, and now we just got to keep taking the next steps forward. So we appreciate this. Thank you.
Coach Hill, appreciate you.
Thank you.
We have a really exciting meeting lined up. You don't need to run off.
Minutes are next if you want some.
Thanks again. The next item on our agenda is the approval of minutes of the joint work session of February 20th, 2018. Councilmember White.
Yes, I have reviewed those and found them to be correct. And I make a motion that we approve those minutes.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilmember White, seconded by Councilmember Blair to approve the minutes. This is a voice vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, they stand approved. Next item is a common consent part of our agenda. It's a appointment to the Ogden Diversity Commission. And so I look for a motion to approve the common consent agenda item.
Go ahead, sorry.
I make a motion that we approve the appointment of Marcy Taylor Rizzi to the Ogden Diversity Commission.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilmember White, seconded by Vice Chair Nadolski, to approve the common consent agenda and the appointment of Marcy Taylor Rizzi to the Ogden Diversity Commission. This is a voice vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Are there any opposed? I think that should fill up the Diversity Commission now, finally, right? Okay, the next item is our new business, fiscal year 2019 budget presentation, and we'll welcome Ms. Janine Eller-Smith to the podium.
Council members, I'm grateful to have this opportunity to present the Ogden City tentative budget. The mayor made the presentation, and tonight you're going to be considering setting the public hearing on this tentative budget. That's an action that is required by state law. We have to adopt both a tentative budget and a final budget. So I want to just go over the process that we've gone through so far. May 1st, you accepted for review the budget that was presented by the mayor and Mr. Johnson. On May 8th, we reviewed in a work session the compensation plan, revenues, BDO lease revenue, proposed tax increases. And then on the 15th, and then again today, we were working on some, or had presentations from some of the department directors. And then that will continue next week, where we won't have a regular meeting, but we will have a work session, and we'll finish up the presentations from the rest of the department directors. And that brings you to June 5th, which is when we will hold the public hearing and take action on that tentative budget. That June 5th date is key because it's also the date when you're going to have to consider whether or not go through a truth and taxation process. So you will also be, on June 5th, you will also consider setting a public hearing on the final budget. And if you are not going to do a truth and taxation, that would go to June 19th. And if you are going to consider that, then it would go to August 7th, which is allows that extra noticing time that's required by state law. There are some key changes in this budget, and I'll do this pretty quickly. The mayor and Mr. Johnson and the administration have recommended a property tax increase that would at least maintain the current tax rate. The revenues that would be produced by that tax increase are not included in this tentative budget. And so right now you're not taking any action on that. That would come later when you adopt the final budget and a schedule A or A1 that will come with that. This budget included step increases for public safety, merit increases up to 4% for regular employees, a COLA for all employees, and funding for some significant projects in parks, facilities maintenance, technology. This is just sort of some of the major funds that you review during the budget process, and this shows the percent changes over the FY18 budget. So you can see on the right-hand side there, percentage changes. Significant change in the airport, that's due to a $5 million grant that the city has now qualified for and will be getting, so that's why there's such a huge increase in that budget. CIP, some significant increases, that's due to a proposed rate increase in the utilities, which is included in the budget. And just so you know, we will not be able to discuss those utility increases for another month or so, just because of the timing of how things are working. But just be aware that those rate increases are included in the budget. That general fund, just pay attention to that $2.3 million increase, just a 4%, because that's going to be significant in just a minute. Staffing details that are included, they are adding 14 and subtracting 5 for a net addition of 9 positions. And I thought that you might like to see what that does to the total employees per 1,000. This isn't necessarily a great measure, but it is a measure against other cities. You recall that I did the research for last year. I didn't update the numbers for the cities we were comparing against. So those are 2016 numbers, which is that 8.92 employees per 1,000 average. That is skewed a little bit because Salt Lake City has about 16 per 1,000. But you can see just adding those 14 positions, how it barely moves the needle on the employees per 1,000, and that's because our population is increasing at the same time. So this is the proposed employee increases, and if you'll notice, it's got the general fund there is $1.7 million. Remember, the total increase in the general fund is 2.3, so the majority of that money increase in the general fund budget is for the employees, and so citywide, it's $2.3 million. One thing that is included that has not been included in the past is council health benefits and other employee benefits. Up until now, the council has not received health benefits. You receive a small salary, and you also receive a small retirement contribution. The city has a compensation committee, and they ran, took a look at the council and benchmarked against these other cities that you can see up there, and determined that all of those other cities provide health benefits and other employee benefits to their city councils and make that available as a regular, just on a regular basis. And so that compensation committee recommended that the council receive health, dental, and life insurance options, and also if for some reason you have coverage through another employer and you want to opt out, there's a small compensation for opting out. And the total cost of that is just a little over $69,000, and we're talking on a $183 million budget, so not a big chunk of money. Revenue highlights, we are seeing some increases in property tax. We have some expiring RDAs that are going to generate additional property tax revenue. Sales tax has been growing really well, thanks to work by our community and economic development people. Franchise and telecommunications are down. And then I just put up here, if in the future you decide to do the property tax increase, the comptroller's office has estimated that that would generate another $827,000. So I went through the budget, I and my staff, to kind of identify things that fit into the council's priorities, promote active and healthy living. A significant amount of money in curb, gutter, and sidewalk, and it's not very sexy, for lack of a better term, but it's really something that's critical, and if our sidewalks are in good repair, that's going to encourage people to get out there and do a little more walking. There's money in park improvements and playground enhancements, money for bike master plan improvements, and for the tree inventory. And I wasn't quite sure where to put this in under your issues, but I thought that this might be a good one. They want to do a tree inventory, and this will help them make sure that the trees throughout the city are maintained in an appropriate way and keep them healthy. Developing multimodal transportation options. It's not in the budget, but the mayor's indicated that we have a grant coming from UTA to initiate the bike share program. And if you recall, we don't recognize grant funds until we actually get them in the budget, so that's why they're not in the budget. But those monies will be coming. And then there's some money for Centennial Trails acquisition and construction. And then I just added that also fits here is bike master plan and curb, gutter, and sidewalk projects. Fostering neighborhoods, community building. There's additional money for the Neighbor Up grant funds. We are working on a campaign to promote those. As you know, we finally issued a check for our very first grant and look forward to, I think that event's June 9th, and hopefully it's really successful for those neighbors. And again, curb, gutter, and sidewalk is so important for our community building. Community outreach and engagement. There's additional money for the planning department so that they can up their mailings and do another open house or two. And then the council chamber technology upgrades. You know, I personally am really excited about that project. Again, it's going to be something that's not very showy. It's going to be behind the scenes, but it's going to help our staff push out your information a little bit easier and make it more accessible to the public, as well as all of the other committees and commissions that use this room. Ensuring fiscal sustainability and transparency. We just had a work session talking about the Enterprise Resource Program and what a significant impact it's having on the city. And while it's difficult right now, it's going to be a tremendous asset for the city going forward. I'm excited about the transparency module. It's another 2 or 3 years out because of some changes that are happening at Tyler, the company that provides that ERP. Once we get closer, my staff and I will work closely with them to make sure that transparency module reflects the kinds of information that you as a council want out there to the public. Supporting public safety and other essential services. This is where the bulk of the money for this particular budget is going. There's fire station number 4 upgrades. That's $1.5 million. New fire apparatus, which is actually happening in this current year. You know, those are $300,000, $350,000. We heard about the protective equipment that's so important for a fire. The additional assistant prosecutor that we heard about tonight from the city attorney, bulletproof vest, the step increases. And then there's also some utility replacement, facilities maintenance funding, and street fundings. And all of those are those essential services that the city is required to provide. And then cultivating arts and culture. This is another area where there's a significant amount of resources. They're doubling the Twilight Concert Series because the arts people have done such a great job. Amphitheater upgrades, the plaza is going to be restored. Corner Information Hub will be put into activity. They're increasing activities at Union Station, and there's also additional money for the arts grants. There is a proposed changes. There's a Schedule A that's included with the tentative budget. It makes changes to the general fund, the CIP, BDO lease revenue, and major grants funds. And that totals $426,000. The general fund is an $85,000 change. They reduced the expenses in at Marshall White because the pool is currently out of commission, and they had considered the reduction in the revenues, but had overlooked the expense side, so there was some changes there. They took that money, put it into CIP, that $150,000. BDO, they're making changes there. We're removing $25,000 that was going to go to an RDA project, but this removes that money and puts it back into fund balance, which is why it zeroes out for BDO. And then the major grants changes are just that true up to the annual action plan that you heard about last week's meeting. So that is a brief overview of the tentative budget and the proposed Schedule A, and it's staff's recommendation that you set the public hearing for June 5th.
Any questions for Ms. Eller-Smith?
Chair Heyer, I have one.
Yes.
So you talked about on page 10, the revenue highlights, the proposed property tax increase. Are you saying that that's holding the certified tax rate the same, correct?
Yes, if you choose to maintain, go through to the taxation and maintain the current rate, that's the estimate that would generate is $827,000.
Any other questions?
I wanted to be clear.
In the budget right now.
Yeah, I just wanted it.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Thanks, Janine. Okay. Any discussion amongst council members? I think regarding the truth in taxation, that was something that the administration had proposed when they presented their proposed budget. I hadn't heard a lot of discussion from citizens or other council members contrary to the need for that. So I think I've assumed that perhaps that's what we're intending to do, is to entertain that idea. But anyway, let's go ahead and get a motion if we can.
Do you have something?
Just real quick.
Yes, please.
It doesn't mean that we will or won't.
It does not.
That's right. We're just setting the public hearing.
Hopefully there is a lot of public input opportunities for the public to inject into this between now and then, particularly on June 5th. That's in 2 weeks, and hopefully we'll have some input for that for
can
us.
Can they go online to read the attended budget then?
The mayor's proposed budget is online.
There's a link
there. Okay, so what's your pleasure?
If you're ready, I will go ahead and make a motion that we adopt proposed ordinance 2018-9 and set the public hearing for June 5th, 2018.
I second.
Hold on.
What? And it's just, we're not adopting, we're just setting the public hearing on that ordinance.
Yep. So just set the public hearing. There's not adopting anything.
Okay.
Second that.
All right. We have a motion by Councilmember Blair, seconded by Councilmember Stevens, to set the public hearing for June 5th on the proposed tentative budget. Is that okay? It's just a voice vote, isn't it? Okay, this is a voice vote. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Are there any opposed? All right, great. Next item on our agenda is public comment. There is a sign-up sheet in the rear of the room. It's not required that you fill that out. It just helps us. There are no names, apparently. So anyway, you can come to the microphone and give us your name for the record, and limit your comments to 3 minutes, please. Any takers? Pardon? Yeah, this is the time for public comment. So if you came to address the council regarding any item, now would be the time.
We're seeing some new faces in the chamber, so that's why we're looking out at you guys.
So my name is Jennifer Hoffman. I live at
Angela Hernandez. I'm here about the ticket ordinance. I want to see if we could revise it. I was a chicken owner, but because of your guys' ordinance, I was had to have my chicken fostered. And I was looking into other places, and our ordinance is nothing like anybody else's. I want a fair and I want the same rights as cat and dog owners have, because she's not a farm animal, she's a pet. For example, I want to know why we have to have 2,000 square feet if the chicken must be in the coop at all times. That makes no sense to me. Also, why do we have to be a homeowner to have a chicken? You don't need to be a homeowner to have a cat or a dog. I'm not saying we're going to have a big old flock, just one chicken. If my owner says it's okay, I don't see why the city council should have any say-so in it at all. I'm going to set a formal date to challenge the fairness of this challenge and ordinance to make it more equal for the residents of Ogden.
Thank you. Is there anyone else?
Yes, my name is Matthew Oquendo. I'm also known as Malik Dio in the activist community. I live here in Ogden on 2679 Jackson Avenue. I'm actually Angie's fiance, and thanks for giving me the time to speak on this today as far as the chicken ordinance is concerned. And so it's very concerning. It's brought emotional distress into our life, having to foster our chicken. We had it for a year as a pet. There's some cultural considerations that I feel are not being taken into place at the city council as well. And this is maybe something the Diversity Commission could look into. Being a Puerto Rican in our culture and Hispanic, Mexican Americans, it's part of our culture and it's normal to have a chicken as a pet. You know, that's not allowing us to be able to partake in that part of the culture if we don't meet the strict and almost unattainable standards that the chicken ordinance has. It's hard for me to figure out whether it was voted on because they knew it was going to be hard and people were going to hardly qualify for it, or if it was voted on because they wanted people to have chickens, because it's just so unattainable. I looked within a 6-block radius of where I live. There's hardly anybody at all that has a backyard of 2,000 square feet. We got to question the common sense of the ordinance as well. Why would it matter if there's pavement on the property in the 2,000 square feet? Why doesn't the pavement count or structures count if they have to be kept in the coop at all time? That makes no sense whatsoever. I challenge the common sense on that. I also challenge the common sense on whether you have to be a live-in homeowner if the homeowner gives you permission. As stated earlier, you know, the city council shouldn't decide whether a homeowner can give that right or not. And there's just a lot of other things about the ordinance that seem unfair and that are unprecedented as to other ordinances in the United States and even here in Utah. So we want to go ahead and set a date to re-challenge those items and other items that we feel are unfair in the ordinance. And we want to make this ordinance more fair to everybody in Ogden, because right now it's only fair to people in zip codes who have big backyards. Your typical Ogden resident does not qualify to have chickens in their backyard, and that makes the ordinance totally unfair. Totally unfair. And just the uncommon sense things in the ordinance, such as the 2,000 square feet in the backyard being that they have to be cooped and live in ownership, that's just seems like the council made it intentionally more difficult to own a chicken rather than making it more attainable. That's all I have to say for now.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that wishes to address the council? I'll take that as a no. Unless somebody's really wanting to talk. Don't want to cut you off. Okay, well, we'll move on. Comments, we want to excuse the mayor tonight, but we want to ask for comments from Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, sir. To answer a question I was asked earlier that I didn't have current information, we currently have 17 who have licensed chickens, which is 92 chickens. So it's an average of about 5.41 chickens per application. We've had 78 chicken complaints to animal and code enforcement since December, and that has taken 18.2 hours to investigate. That may be more information than you asked for, but we're trying to be thorough. I would like to call attention to the many volunteers, city workers who put on an amazing marathon, and good weather doesn't hurt an amazing marathon. We estimate that we had thousands and thousands of people here on Saturday. It was an amazing day, and we're grateful to the Gold Foundation and to our own employees and the county employees who put so much effort into that. Since we won't have a council meeting, we'll have a work session before June 7th. I just wanted to remind you that June 7th is the first night of Twilight. Be the first of 10 concerts. I'm sure they'll let you in with your Weber State uniforms if you choose. But I think this year we have I'm told we have a great lineup, and I'm told, because I don't know any of the bands, that that's a good thing. That means that they're good, and they'll be popular. So we're really excited about the Twilight this year. One last thing, if you haven't plugged in May 9th and 10th and 11th and 12th for next year on your calendar, please block it out. We have a running clock down at Union Station doing the countdown towards the 150-year celebration of the driving of the Golden Spike. The festivities will be many that will be here during that time frame, and so I encourage you to block out those days on your calendar so that you can have fun being involved in the festivities. May 9th, most of the festivities will be here in Ogden. The Big Boy Train, which, if you don't know much about trains, is a novelty. It's one of the great trains. There's only two of them like that anymore, and the Big Boy, amongst other trains, will be here. The estimation is there'll be probably 25 to 30,000 people a day that will be coming just to see the trains. Union Pacific is kind of bringing the who's who of Union Pacific here. Southern Pacific will be here for a trade show. There'll be a lot of fun things. Hopefully you'll go up to Promontory on the 10th, where they reenact the driving of the Golden Spike. My understanding is the Mormon Tabernacle Choir will be singing up there. It'll be quite a festive event. So we're a little ways out, but there's a lot that's going to be happening, and that'll be a big, big weekend for Ogden City and for Northern Utah. So it's something to look forward to. That's all I have.
All right, thank you. Council members, any comments? Councilmember Lopez.
Thank you, Chair. I have a question for Mr. Johnson. You mentioned complaints. How many?
78 since December.
And do we know before that, when we didn't have an ordinance in place, what kind of average were we getting of complaints?
I don't have that information tonight, but I can get it.
Thank you.
Always ask a question I don't know the answer to. Thank you very much.
I'm just curious to know if before we
if had it's gotten more or less, yeah,
gotten more or less,
and then we'll find that out and get that
and
for
maybe
you.
Maybe even try to find out maybe why.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other comments, council members?
I thought the marathon was one of the great events, and Mark Saul ran in his first 5K, and he had some comments about that. He says, "I'd love to be able to say I felt this amazing sense of accomplishment wash over me as I approached the finish line of my first race. But all I realized was the exhaustion. I couldn't savor the moment as barely remembering crossing the finish line. I do remember stopping hands on knees, asking one in particular, is it over? Am I done? Can I stop? The statistic answer came from the medical camp. No, we need to keep moving so you don't get sick. Keep moving, I thought, beyond the finish line? Did I not sign up for the 5K, not for the 5.1K? Listen, if I wanted to keep moving past this point, I would have signed up for the half marathon. Then he commented that the Gold Foundation made a great effort, and it was a great event for us, and they did an outstanding job. But he first had that experience in, I guess, his bucket list. He said as he approached the finish line, he felt like is this a real good experience for me? And then into the race, about halfway, he says, why am I here? Why should I be subject to this type of situation? But that was the experience that he had, and I'm sure everyone else had a great experience.
Thank you. Any other comments? Okay. I'll look for a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Lopez, seconded by Councilmember White to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? All right. That's a wrap. Thanks for being here, everyone.